President Biden's poll numbers have gotten slightly better recently, but he's still lagging far behind in voter enthusiasm. A new poll shows that even a majority of his own supporters, this is about the poll show, a majority of his own supporters wish that he wasn't running. And that lack of enthusiasm could be very painful in November. Now, again, I always ask, are we allowed to talk about this? Because, you know, are people going to start crying and you know, send us ugly hate mail because we're talking about this? Are we allowed to talk about this?
We have to, whether we're allowed to or not. And you know, sometimes, folks, we do have to address the ugly truth here. And this poll shows us that 62%, not of 62% of voters, 62% of Biden supporters say, man, I really wish it wasn't him. I wish it was anybody else on that ballot in November. But they say we're probably still going to vote for him. You know, maybe we'll see what happens. But it's a lack of enthusiasm, and that's horrible for Biden.
Yeah, it is. The enthusiasm issue is, and you know, the way it's manifesting itself, your enthusiasm issue. Fewer voters say in 2024 that the presidential race really matters. Fewer voters than happened just the last cycle. Now, you've got this crazy man, James Carville, believing that we can just beat everybody into submission, which is just the opposite. I mean, this guy's gone nuts. See, this curmudgeon old lizard-looking guy with his cap going on television and saying that the youth, that the effing, we'll play it, the effing youth are just stupid and lazy, and this is going to cost them the election. Now, really? Are you that desperate to where you send your biggest voice, James Carville, who's been the voice for the Democrats for decades now, and now he's out there saying these words, you effing young voters basically are so stupid and so lazy that you're not going to show up for Biden. What the hell? I mean, when have we gotten to where that's what we ought to be doing in politics?
Yeah, just screaming at these people that, you've got to do what...
We'll show this. Yeah. You'll see and you go, what?
Are you kidding me? Is this the United States of America? Is this the nation that was founded on the principle that no person is above the law? And then you tell these young people, if you don't get involved right now, in this election, they're going to be involved in your life for the rest of your frickin' life. And if Trump and Roberts and Alito and Gorsuch and Thomas and Leonard Leo and the Heritage Foundation, if they get a hold, there will be no government left. There will be no rights left. You'll live under theocracy. You'll end up Christian nationalism. But that's all right, you little fucking 26-year-old. You don't feel like the election's important to me. They're not addressing the issues that I care about. Well, the New York Times Harvard Youth Poll, which is a pretty good, well-regarded thing, a guy named John Della Volpe. And very recently, they gave youngsters the 10, 15 most important issues. Clocking in at number 14 was student debt. You wouldn't know that if you read the fucking press. Number 15 was the issue of Palestine. High on the list was abortion, was interest rates, was housing affordability, were all of these other things. You are being insufficiently served by the commentariat, and to some extent, you're being insufficiently served through Democratic messages. So my advice to tell these young people to get off your motherfucking ass and go vote, because you should vote like your entire future and the entire future of this United States depends on it, because quite frankly, it does. And that's not an exaggeration.
Look, the problem is, once again, we got a repeat of 2020. These guys are not exciting. You know, even Trump's own base, not as energetic.
No,
like he's not getting the same crowds at the rallies.
No.
Everybody right now just has this fatigue because politics has become front and center for so many years. Mm-hmm. It used to be we'd be doing this and we're talking to the kind of outliers, the few people that follow politics.
Right.
Well, now everybody does.
Yeah.
And Yeah. They're tired of it. I know we're tired of it.
Saturation,
exactly.
It? Well, but you talk about more. I mean, you do show every single day where you're talking about politics. I don't. So, but I already feel a saturation.
Yeah.
Both these guys. I mean, I'm tired of talking about it. I'm just absolutely tired of talking. And so that probably is one of the biggest problems, the enthusiasm problem. Some they have to overcome.
Well, and there's a way for Biden to fix that. He says, okay, obviously, you know, yes, I'm old. I'm a little slower. Y'all aren't excited about me. So let me give you something to be excited about. What if I pick a new running mate? What if I promise a bit of a shakeup in my cabinet, because the cabinet has not been great? You know, look, here's the people I got lined up. You know, these will be the folks in the White House if you pick me again. Give them something to be excited about, because it's not you, so give them a new person somewhere.
You know why you'll never go to Washington? Because you're too damn smart. That's a problem. Farron, thanks for joining me, okay?
Thank you.
That's all for this week, but all these segments, well, they're going to be posted right here on this channel in the coming week, so make sure that you're subscribed. I'm Mike Papantonio, and this has been America's Lawyer, where every week we tell you the stories that corporate media won't tell you because their advertisers will cut off their advertising if they tell that story, or their political connections are so Republican or so Democrat that they can't color outside the lines there. We don't have that problem, as you can see watching this program. Hope to see you next time.
Helped dirty money flow through its branches around the world, including at least 800...
Plaintiffs allege that the defendants provided money and medical goods to terrorist groups Hezbollah and Jaish al-Mahdi.
This is a well-organized business for these individuals that carry out these attacks. Terrorism is a business, and they run it like a business.
They knew about what was going on for a decade. They absolutely, no question about it, knew that HSBC was washing money. They had every reason to understand it was for terrorism and it was for drug cartels. Took no action whatsoever.
These banks are involved. Their accounts are connected, and they're using them to mask the transactions. The more complicated they can make the transactions, the more distance they can put between the bad guys and the seemingly legitimate purpose of these funds.
They pay $1.9 billion, which is a drop in the bucket compared to what they've made. And nobody goes to prison. These CEOs, these bankers that made this decision, they're safe at home. They know what they've done. It's resulted in the death of Americans, contractors and soldiers, not just hundreds, but thousands. And we look the other way because they don't look like criminals. The die is cast. The people that are responsible for are on Wall Street.
And they don't look like criminals. It's almost a suspension of disbelief. Sometimes I'll have people call me and say, is this real? Do they really get away with this? Yeah, they do.